Good afternoon, everybody. My name is Chika from the University of Adelaide in Australia, and I'm a member of the Institute. Today, when we look at the dynamics of society, I could say that the only thing that is constant is changing itself. And therefore, it gives me great pleasure to introduce a scholar who I could only describe as a dynamic constant. Mm-hmm. And Professor Kainer has been both, you know, has been weaving what we can call new narrative possibilities, as well as challenge and alter existing ones in convergent media landscape through combining the powers of film, television, visual art, games, cultural theory, and literary theory to come with what she calls a new kind of interactive storytelling, one that is formally experimental, intellectually challenging, and emotionally compelling. She has been a leading force in determining the direction of these new modes of expression. She is the founding director of The Labyrinth, and this is based at USC, the Anime College of Center for Communication, through which she has overseen the direction and development of DVD RAMs, interactive installations, and the websites that have taken materials traditionally made for film, television, or books, and transformed them into award-winning database and documentaries. Hina is also a professor in the Division of Critical Studies in the USC School of Cinema and Television, where she has been teaching since 1980. She is a prolific writer and scholar who has so many books, in fact, has written up to 10 textbooks and over 100 scholarly publications, some of which, let me just mention just a few. Blood Cinema, the Reconfiguring of the National Identity in Spain, The Dawn of My Back, Memoirs of Black Texas Upbringing and Interactive Cultural History, Playing with Power in Movies, Television, and Video Games from Muppet Babies to Teenage Mutant Ninjas, Benyus, the District Charm of the Bourgeoisie, Tracing the Decay of Fiction, Encounters with Film by Pat O'Neill, Mysteries and Desires, Searching the World of John Ritchie, Kids, Media, Culture, Counsel in Passion. And of course, Close Up a Critical Perspective on Cinema. I mean, there's a host of others. In recognition of the innovative interdisciplinary research, she has been named a professor in 2001. Her contributions and in academic and creative work will take more than the day we have to, than the time we have today to explain. Therefore, I would rather present Professor Kainer in flesh and in time, real time to you. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much for that introduction. In 1997, I was presented with an offer I couldn't refuse. I was then a professor of critical studies in the School of Cinema Television, and I was asked to develop a research initiative that would somehow create a productive dialogue between the immersive language of cinema and the database possibilities, the interactive possibilities and database structures of digital media. And so immediately I leapt forward and created the Labyrinth Project, this research initiative. And after hosting a conference called Interactive Frictions in 1999, we then focused this initiative on producing works at the pressure point between theory and practice. In other words, the kinds of works that I was talking about, but that really were, there weren't that many out there in the universe. And we ended up creating a body of works, 12 since 1999, works that combine cultural history with artistic practice, or with what Lev Manovich calls information aesthetics, works that dramatize the archive, works that blatantly fuse fiction and history, a combination of two narrative modes that transmits ideology and also shapes, I think, contemporary subjectivity. And we developed a specialty in two subgenres, namely of database documentary, namely digital city symphonies that explore urban space and definitely focus on the local place and saying that the local place matters, and that resonate with the modernist film genre of the city symphony. And the other one was the interactive urban memoirs that really deal with identity, that explore the interior mental space and focus on a complex life in relationship to a specific historical and cultural context. And thus far, we've done three of those, one with Chicano gay writer John Retchie. It's called Mysteries and Desires, Searching the Worlds of John Retchie. And then also with the African-American filmmaker, photographer Carol Parrott Blue, Dawn at My Back, Memoirs of a Black Texas Upbringing. And that was released in relationship to her autobiography. And then finally, this last one we just did on Albert Einstein, Three Winters in the Sun, Einstein in California. And that's part of the traveling Albert Einstein show now is celebrating, you know, his miraculous year of 1905. All of these works were built on a multi-tiered collaboration. The first thing I did was to assemble a group of three digital artists, Rosemary Camella, Christy Kang, and Scott Mahoy. And we would also work with paid students, assistants from USC and from a whole range of departments, not only from production and animation and our new interactive division, but also from critical studies, from urban studies, from Slavic studies, really throughout the university. So it's very transdisciplinary in its emphasis. We also were working with independent artists and scholars, independent filmmakers like Pat O'Neill, Peter Forgash, Nina Mankus, scholars like, Norman Klein, and you'll see other ones I'll mention when I show you specific works. The collaboration also extended to institutions, museums, archives, other universities, and cultural centers. And some of these institutions have provided some of our funding, but they've also, you know, really helped to develop conceptually what we were doing. And indeed, when working with artists and scholars, there's no sense of content providers who then turn the content over to the tech people, not in any way, and it seems like this is not in any way the way you're working either, but rather there's this collaboration on conceptual design, of the interface design, and that's one of the most exciting parts of the whole project. We really have, and I want to make three other points about our interactive narratives, which have to do with, when I say we're working at the pressure point between theory and practice, what does that mean in very specific terms? Well, for one thing, it means that we're very much about transmedia migration. In other words, combining old and new media, refusing to fetishize the newness of now, and that this is totally unique and all that sort of thing, but rather that there's a continuity with theater, with film, with literature, and these earlier forms, ritual, etc. And also, transmedia migration also defines myself, because I started out as a scholar of 18th century English literature. Before being told that I was in moving to film, I was betraying the 18th century. And I've been betraying it ever since, moving from one to another. Also, we're very much involved in developing what we call transmedia interactive networks, transmedia interactive networks. We usually start with an installation in public space that draws attention to the project. And then we develop on the basis that we watch it being tested, how it's being played, and then we develop and release a redistribution, a DVD-ROM, and frequently with a booklet with it, book or booklet. And then also a website for international access and updating. And finally, in all of these projects, we continue to emphasize the role of the narrative field, to think that narrative's important. A lot of new media theorists are arguing, narrative's obsolete, it's being replaced by databases, particularly somebody like Lev Manovich argues this. I really think that's wrong, and that narrative, in fact, is, I take a very broad approach to that as a cognitive approach to narrative as a way of contextualizing the meaning and an emotive response to perceptions, and that it carries ideology, and that it has these cognitive, ideological, and aesthetic functions, and that it also is compatible with spatial navigation, database structures, both emergent and interactivity. Okay, today, in this very brief presentation, I'm going to give brief glimpses of three projects that I hope show the arc of our work. I'm going to start, let's see here. I start? Oh, yeah, here. I'm having a problem with my mouse here. I'm going to start with Tracing the Decay of Fiction, which is a work we developed in collaboration with filmmaker Pat O'Neill. And it was at the beginning when we were really working with, when we were establishing our track record. We had no track record, and working with, in collaboration here. This work also emphasizes the combination of the immersive quality of cinema with the database structures.
What are you doing tonight?
It uses the hotel as a literary trope and as a structure that is a reservoir of cultural memories and historical traumas. Sounds and images.
And that night, my father set up a buffet and all my
It uses the hotel because we think of the hotel as a wonderful kind of space that combines public and private space. It's a space in which you have many stories in competing for control of the basic narrative. It was used certainly in novels. You know, my background, Henry Fielding, but also Buñuel. You think of The Phantom of Liberty, a work like that. Okay, so, and specifically for the Ambassador Hotel, it's the place we know where Bobby Kennedy was assassinated. It's also a place where it's very important to the history of Los Angeles. It's the place where the downtown power brokers and the Hollywood movie industry came together. And it's the place on the Miracle Mile that changed Los Angeles' orientation spatially from a north-south to an east-west orientation. Now, what happens when you come in is You come into one of at random. You can 13 spaces. You can navigate the camera moves. Explore the space on the one hand, but on the other hand, you can also explore the space through the architect's original diagrams and go directly to wherever you want to be.
Interior of the coconut grove.
Okay, I'm sorry. Yeah.
Interior of the coconut grove nightclub.
As you're navigating, it's possible to call up figures from the past, ghostly traces of people who have inhabited these spaces, make them disappear. You can also call up the archive stills.
In Los Angeles, celebrities headed by Lawrence Melchior arrive for the 6th Imperial Ball. With her husband and the Richard Egans, Jane Russell, who founded the Adoption Fund, which benefits from the ball. Esther Williams and Jeff Chandler, a few of the Hollywood luminaries who are brought together with Los Angeles society leaders and nobility. The guest of honor, Princess...
J. Edgar Hoover came to the hotel every year because Donna La Jolla...
And Walter and June Winchell and Walda, their daughter, spent a lot of time at the hotel.
So it's possible
but June was a lovely woman,
and
she had been a...
There's many of these archival stills that are here. So this is an area.
You know the story, of course, the Coconut Grove, that the palm trees there were taken from a Rudolph Valentino set, creating that wonderful environment, that sort of 1920s love of Arabian, Mediterranean, Spanish motifs.
I'm going to go back here now, though.
The embassy ballroom is seen from the backstage. The embassy ballroom is seen from the backstage passageway leading to the kitchen.
What I think is quite clear is that we can work together in the last analysis, and that what has been going on within the United States over the period of the last 3 years, the divisions, the violence, the disenchantment with our society, the divisions, whether it's between blacks and whites, between the poor and the more affluent.
Throughout, you also look for hot spots. More materials there. And when you go back to the same hot spot, you get something different every time.
The presence of a gunman in addition to Sirhan can be determined by a simple count of the bullets recovered from the scene of the assassination. 2 bullets were found in Senator Kennedy's head and neck. 5 were recovered from various bystanders who were wounded by stray fire. 2 bullets were recovered from the pantry doors, and 1 was found in a rear door frame. Altogether, 10 bullets were recovered.
It's also possible to go outside in terms of the Miracle Mile and explore other spaces here, for example. And with different cultural.
Los Angeles has changed radically since I moved here in 1971. It's been totally transformed in terms of the economic and social structure of the city. And there are 2 main areas in which these changes have been focused. First is in the industrial structure of the city, and the second is in the ethnic or demographic structure of the city. When I came here in 1971, Los Angeles was still essentially an industrial city. There was a substantial amount of heavy industry.
At the end of World War I and the years following World War I,
the
sentiment began to accrue in the Los Angeles Chamber of
Commerce
circles that for Los Angeles to really emerge as an important American city, and especially to have an opportunity of bringing the 1932 Olympics into the city, and especially to serve the tourist industry, which was beginning to emerge as the second or third leading element in the economy of Los Angeles County, that Los Angeles just had to have better first-class hotels. And directly out of this sensibility came 2 hotels, the Ambassador Hotel, which was the first, designed by Myron Hunt, followed by the Biltmore Hotel.
My name is Carlin Frank Benjamin, and I lived at the Ambassador from 1921 to 1938, in the age of a couple of months till I was 17 years old. I grew up in a hotel. It's a great place to grow up in. I had my own phone, conference calls on the weekends that the chief operator would set up with my girlfriends, and I had the run of the hotel and the swimming pool, the golf course, the tennis courts, the movie theater, the Coconut Grove. I was the horizontal Eloise because I lived on 23 acres rather than a 25-story plaza hotel. I met Lindbergh when he came back from Paris, and I met Admiral Byrd, who stayed there, and Pola Negra, who was a famous silent movie actress, lived in the bungalow next to it.
There's also a sound piece.
Just a game. Somebody wins, somebody loses.
You. Anywhere without you. Tell me you went. You black, but he didn't tell me you went. But he didn't tell me.
the possibility of a remixing of the sound and images, but again, at the notion of all of these images and these perceptions being somehow part of this cultural repository. And the reason why we very blatantly combine fiction and history is because we think that those two narrative modes really do shape ideology and subjectivity. Now, if you stay here long enough, eventually there's an earthquake where you get a random selection of images and sounds that combine together. And then we help invite you to attempt you to stay longer in the space, but also to combine things in other ways. Maybe I'll just show you a couple more spaces and then we'll move on, because I'm aware that there's not that much time.
The swimming pool is seen facing north toward the main building.
Now again, as I said, if you go in again, you get something different every time. Or
one night in the Star Club, before a great many people, Mr. Hoover talked very loud to me. He bawled me out, very loud. Among other things, he said, "You go back and tell your friends." I said, "They're not my friends, John. I don't know."
Marilyn Monroe was, of course, every Saturday they would have a bathing suit contest, and she was going to modeling school there. And she, of course, was discovered there by a kind of a phony thing that was put in the newspaper saying that Howard Hughes had discovered her, but he had not. At that time, he was in the hospital on an iron lung after an accident he had in Beverly Hills with his plane.
You might wonder why we blanked her out. Well, obviously for copyright reasons, which is connects to what's coming up. Well, that gives you, I think, an idea of this particular project. I'm sorry we didn't get an earthquake. From there, you know, it was really this piece that helped us to see that what we were making was database documentary. And when we exhibit this, and this has been really shown at a lot of new media festivals, film festivals worldwide, and when we do show it, we show it in large screen projection with three computers, and so it's possible to have three people at a time. And so it gives the impression of, on the one hand, surveillance, surveillance cameras, but also the arcade experience and also synchronized surfing, you might say. And when we showed it at ZKM, the Future Cinema Show, we had in the room next door, Pat O'Neill's film, and then our interactive piece right next to it, so people could go between the two. And both of them resist narrative closure. That's one of the reasons why there's a great emphasis on film noir and conspiracy theories in this project, because they're both forms that demonstrate that the drive toward narrative closure may be motivated by paranoia. Okay. This is a piece that we did about a specific place, Pasadena. Now this moves much more toward cultural history. The fictional elements enter through myths and oral histories, but I think we see it as really trying to visualize the database structure and to make very explicit the competition for what holds center stage and allowing the interactor to decide what holds center stage in the narrative space. We developed this project in collaboration with the Auto Club. We had gone to them before, they're one of the archives that provided a lot of our imagery, and they liked some of the things we had done, and therefore they wanted to do a piece together. So it was a combination exhibition of re-photography at the Pasadena Museum for California Art. And so there was the traditional, you know, two photographs on the walls, 24 pairs, plus a print catalog, plus this interactive work as an installation. And it was very, very popular. And so the show now is running indefinitely. And what we're doing is we're installing in the museum, a place where people from the community can come and bring their own imagery, their own home movies, their own photographs, dictate their own story. So you come into the project, and one of the things that you see is we're in the category of colonizing, but it's possible to choose any one of these categories as well. I'm going to change to bungalow just to... It's moving a little slowly here. Okay. We can move along, and at any point, any image can become large screen, and with any of the pairs, you can go between the older still, the archival still, and what it is now, and stop in between in any way. We found a number of our projects feature this dimension of these what we call bleed-throughs. It also is present in the project we did with Norman Klein, and we found there was a lot of pleasure in the galleries in doing that, being able to control that. And it's also showing, you know, not just what sometimes not much changes happen, and that's as interesting as when there is a great deal of change, we think. Okay, so it's possible also, once you get an image on the bottom, you can go into more detail in developing any of these topics. It's also possible to get commentary. Maybe it's possible to get commentary. It's also, we can go back at any time to the main categories. There's also footage, live, you know, action footage.
At what other period in history has anyone been interested in housing the common person? But in this style, I mean, it's a house, maybe you think it's ugly, but it has style. And it's a nice way of living. A bungalow is really a cottage. It's related to the Queen Anne cottage, but the term itself refers, of course, to Bengal, Banga, Bangladesh. And it's called a bungalow in Bangladesh. The British picked up on this idea. It's essentially one-story house. Sometimes there's a little cheating in the roof, and a couple of rooms are put upstairs. And as I say, it can be afforded by people, but lots of them were mortgaged in the great period of building was 1920s, and they were mortgaged heavily, and people lost them in the Depression. The picture with the little boy and girl suggests so much about the house. It's my idea of the way people should live. Maybe it would be nicer to live in a larger house than this, but one should remember that this kind of house was the sort of thing that the common person could afford, barely afford.
When my aunt and uncle bought a house on Chester in that block, which they now call Bungalow Heaven, when they first purchased a house there, it was like, how amazing. You know, they've crossed this line, they've gone past Lake Street.
There's that section that's called Bungalow Heaven, where...
I'm just going to go on, but you can see you can pick your own context here. Categories. You can also.
Has anyone been interested in housing the common person? But in this style, I mean, it's a house.
You can also go for index and these other kinds of issues.
And it's a nice way. A bungalow is really a cottage. Related to the Queen Anne cottage,
but and also you can get to the various commentators, you can get essays as well. And when we get to the credits, it's also possible to go to any of the archives where we've taken these images from and go and get more materials from the archive. I'm going fast because I have another one I want to show you. One of the things that's been really interesting every time we've showed this in any public place, particularly at history conferences, people have come up and said, I have all sorts of other pictures. And in fact, we have incorporated them. We're building the website now. It doesn't yet exist. Okay, and the other thing about this project is that the interface design is something that's transferable, and we're using it in other projects, just reskinning it. And in fact, we're developing it now, a new project, new science project called On Genes That Control Aggression in Mice and Men. And it's a project called A Tale of Two Mouths, and we're going to be also using this kind of interface design. The last project I want to show you is something that's going on, it's in development. It's web-based courseware, Russian modernism, online courseware on Russian modernism, so it will. And this is being developed in Flash, and it creates an online learning community. And we're planning to make this software open source and with a set of tools available to others at other institutions. I'm hoping Dartmouth might be interested in developing part, adding to it, because all of the sections have an open architecture that can be added to by
Welcome
other classes.
Welcome to this course on Russian modernism and its international dimensions.
Up?
A period when art was politically explosive.
Okay. Every time when you enter, you get a different painting from the database that just automatically comes up. We thereby introduce the bomb, which is a continuing motif that runs and the fragmentation that runs throughout the whole thing. We now come to the material cultural zone, and you're able to select any of these objects. We're hoping that other people will be adding other objects. I'll just sort of take
As soon as Wilhelm Röntgen produced the first x-rays in the 1890s in Munich, his invention gained immediate recognition in Russia. Being able to see through surfaces and to record internal structures in a black and white photograph fascinated both natural scientists and occult philosophers. If the aspiration of Russian modernism was towards the internal and the private, the X-ray now enabled you to see beyond the world of appearances and perceive the essence. In the effort to reduce compositions to a bare efficacy, the constructivist design in particular seems to be an artistic metaphor for the X-ray.
Okay, we now go to, this takes us to GOOM Arcade, which is in fact our interface. And this will also give us an opportunity to distinguish between modernism and modernity. We don't have that voiceover yet. But now we're really confronted with the three main components of this work that are also featured in the others. Work. Namely, it's the archive, and we started with the materials from the Institute for Modern Russian Culture, which we have at USC. That's just doubled the size of its collection. I'm not going to go here because it's a web connection. I'm not going to take the time. But there's also a personal notebook. The student can download any of the material that's in the archive, and we have included additional materials, say, from New York Public Library, and we want to add other links to other collections. There's also the game, and then there's the individual pathways, which are the lectures. Now, this collaboration is not only at USC, but it's with other scholars at other schools. Yuri Sivian at the University of Chicago, Olga Matic is a literary scholar at Berkeley, John Bolt at USC, but we're hoping to bring in other scholars as well. I'll start with the tango. This is one of Yuri Sivian's. And this draws on materials from the archive too. He divided this into three sections. Are from the period. They also, the labels are authentic, and the students will be able to use this in their projects. Fashion is
Clearly
another
no
one.
A hobble skirt would suit the tango dancer. The tango skirts needed to be loose. It needed a slit, or better, a bow-shaped cut in the front, as we can see in this 1913 Russian postcard called The Tango, and on the Russian cartoon of 1916 picturing the Italian film diva and the queen of new fashions, Lida Borelli, a daring dancer like this Russian tango star Elsa Kruger, who also posed for the postcard, would go as far as Kruger also appeared in this 1914 movie by Yevgeny Bauer, wearing stylish dresses like this. John Bolt mentions in one of his articles that Russian futurist artist Natalia Goncharova was Elsa Kruger's friend and used to design her dresses. It is quite possible that the dresses that Kruger wears in her film Silent Witnesses were designed by Goncharova.
The actress here, Elsa Kruger, is a professional tango dancer. She's not shown dancing here, but by the way she moves when she says, "Yes, I agree, I will marry you," we can tell the degree to which the tango had influenced the body language of 1914.
I'll just take one more. This one is on underwear, does not yet have the voiceover, but you see the range of materials that we're working with. The exercises have not yet been designed for this particular pathway, but it also works with some of this material that Yuri Sevian did on his the CD-ROM that he did with us called Immaterial Bodies that won the British Academy Award for Best interactive in the learning category. Okay, we can go back. Each one of these pathways can be different not only in content but also in style and interface. If we go to the nothingness
in
pathway.
In his essay, The Supremacist Mirror of 1926, Kazimir Malevich, perhaps the foremost artist of Russian modernism and a pioneer of abstract painting, wrote, "The world is nothing." Let's try to find out how he arrived at this strange statement. If 19th century culture celebrated the object, furniture, real estate, food, in defined spaces, modernism rejected both materialism and conventional perimeters. In Russia, writers and artists rejected everything, concrete things and measurable relationships, in their search for nothing, replacing presence with absence.
Now this figure becomes the interface. It also is related to a...
There was once a red-haired man who had no eyes and no ears. He also had no hair, so he was called red-haired only in a manner of speaking. He wasn't able to talk because he didn't have a mouth. He had no nose either. He didn't even have any arms or legs. He also didn't have a stomach and he didn't have a back. He didn't have a spine, and he also didn't have any other insides. He didn't have anything. So it's hard to understand whom we're talking about, so we better not talk about him anymore.
This is a text from the period. Okay, but we're also using this figure as an interface device. Again, playing between the fullness of representation and then the abstraction and the reduction. Okay, and then the one of the assignments that the student has is to curate a show about nothingness. And so they have to go to the archives, they have to pick what it's going to be. This is just a setup here of someone who's selected. And then they have to write, they decide on the order, the sequence, and then they write the didactics, they write the catalog and that sort of thing. All right, but let's go back to Goom. And now the game. The game is called, well, let me just. And we want to use montage, not just, you know, thematically, but also to which drives the structure. Focused on building this first level, this expo, this 1896 expo. It may turn into the Tottling Tower where we never finish, but it's been very formidable. But we were very fortunate to find these fantastic collections of photographs of this expo at the New York Public Library, and they let us use them in the game. So we're using montage as a way of moving between these 2D photographs and the 3D models, and also to jump from one level and one time period to another. These are some of the raw materials from the archive. So everything was being built from the archive, and we think that it's in the process of helping to build these things that students really learn about the period. Okay, now what did we do with this? I'm going to show you here. This is the first demo that we're using of the game, which we just have as a linear demo here, but we're now in the process of adapting it to a game with a Half-Life 2 engine. So we're doing that modification now, and it's playful, we hope.
What you'll see before you in this...
Could we put the sound up a bit?
The world. Please, Monsieur Gendarme, stay in your
seat. I don't know why we've got pink color here.
The ticking noise you hear is the sound of progress. The progress of one picture after another. The progress of science. The progress of life itself. Ladies and gentlemen, voila, la cinematograph.
I don't know what's happened, why we got these... pink color. This is our avatar, Vera. Now, it's possible to move ahead. One controls the fate of one's avatar in the game, and then there's three possible pathways. Technology, if she connects with the projectionist, engage with the projectionist, the art pathway, or the radical politics. And if she looks in the mirror, it's possible to get her backstory through inner speech.
If you go to school, who will watch the horses and milk the cow? And why do you need to read? Knowledge is for sinners.
Verouchka, my little dove, I want you to have this book. Learn to read it. It will teach you.
Batushka, now what am I going to do with your four daughters? Yeah, tell me that before you die. They'll see my talent right off, and then I'm set. Nizhny's just a stage. That's it, just a stage. Then on to Moscow, Petersburg, maybe even Paris.
Okay, now as she's in this Oman's cafe, she has the possibility of exploring this space and interacting with any of these other characters in the space.
The cinematograph, it is not a cheap trick like the X-rays. You see the past, you see the future, and best of all, you see France. The cinematograph, it is a time machine.
That's no time machine, monsieur. That's just a singer sewing a different kind of ribbon. It takes a woman to know. There. It should work now.
Ah, la femme russe. She is beautiful, practical, and rude. Who could ask for more in a woman or an assistant?
Now, if she goes with this, if she becomes the assistant, this is what happens. Here we've drawn from Andrei Rublev. So there's the intertextuality runs through it in a, we hope, a playful way. And at the Paris Expo in 1900, they did have such a simulation ride, in fact. And it did catch on fire, though Vera was not there. Yeah. So in this game, you cannot be a historical figure. You can't be the czar. You can't be Lenin. Here she is encountering the radical student. And if she connects with, if she follows him to return the package, this was... Another site being built, planned to be built. Okay. Or back in Oman, she can interact with the writer.
The cinema will make our nerves crave the fantastic and tire of everyday life. This growing sensualism will lead us astray. The spectacle of the Paris morgue at the end of the 19th century will return to Moscow at the beginning of the 20th.
No, how morbid. What bitter soul could imagine such things about the future?
Bitter is my name.
Won't you buy me a cup of tea, Mr. Bitter?
Gorky, Maxim Gorky.
What do you do? Is it a secret?
I'm a writer. I'm reporting on the expo for the Odessa News and the Nizhny Page.
From far away, a courier train heads right towards you. Watch out. The viewing public shifts nervously in their seats. At any moment, this machine of iron and steel could burst out into the darkness of the room and crush everything.
Though I noticed you didn't budge.
Oh, dear God. I'm no Anna Karenina.
You've read Tolstoy. Listen, what was your name?
Vera Pavlovna.
All right, Vera, of course.
I know I'm going over here, so I'm just trying to... Okay, wait a minute. Well, anyway, she possibly could go with him. There, she also goes out aside on the expo. And the expo, also in the School of Engineering, they're also building a cyclogram, which has the... the characters and the expo and the characters, and there are going to be 40 characters that you can interact with in this space. So it really is involved in the notion of helping to build it as a way of learning about it. And we started with Russian modernism because it has many of the aesthetic principles that are crucial, we think, to developing new media. But this is a model for which will be adapted to other contents. The next one we're thinking of is Pacific Island culture. So thank you very much.
My name is John Willinsky, and I'm from the University of British Columbia. It's no reason to leave, actually. I'm one of the visiting fellows here at the Institute, which is about to be renamed the Cyber-Anti-Disciplinarity Institute for the Humanities here at Dartmouth. Just to draw a kind of segue across these, we've had, and out of respect for David's love of alliterations, we've had mendacious mobilities rather, with David, and mediaitization with Marianne, migratory media with Marsha, and now we have criminality. It didn't quite work with Kembrew, McLeod. It's my pleasure to introduce Kembrew. He's at the Department of Communication Studies at the University of Iowa. He has among the most interesting websites, I think, that any professor I've certainly had the pleasure of visiting. I've never really had any pleasure visiting professors' websites, but one of the most interesting websites. I went there, to gather some data, which he made freely available. Among the more interesting aspects is he ranks himself and is ranked by Random House's publisher as a professional prankster. It's not one of the normal calling cards of faculty members. And to make his point as if there might be some question about that, in 1998 he copyrighted the phrase freedom of expression, which I now have his permission to use only temporarily here this afternoon. But more interesting, or at least as part of that trend, and he now has a book, Freedom of Expression, further copyrighting the title of the book with Random House. But he also had a photograph, a rather unusual photograph, wearing a pig's nose and antlers, which I thought was unusual enough for a professor on his home page. But then he goes on to explain he was at the time marrying 100 people, which I also thought was rather unusual, but he was marrying them to bananas. And I thought there was some kind of comment there on the current state of things in the United States. I'm from Canada. This is all new to me. Only in America is an expression we sometimes use, although we are employing many more people as call center workers now because we can resemble Americans so well. Kembrew has other books as well, one called Owning Culture, Authorship, Ownership, and Intellectual Property. But he also works in the media of video. Money for Nothing, did you have problems with Dire Straits? Money for Nothing, Behind the Business of Pop Music in 2001, and he currently has a work in progress that I'm hoping we'll hear something about, Copyright Criminals. So I give you Kembrew on digital sampling and copyright criminals. Thank you.
Thank you. It's a pleasure to be here. In fact, I am. I'm going to start off by showing a few minutes from a work in progress titled Copyright Criminals. This is a sampling sport. And my the video presentation and my talk today will revolve around legal, historical, and ethical issues surrounding the practice of sound collage, of digital sampling, or employing the tactic of sound collage in a digital form. So, without any further ado, I will start it. Could you turn it up a little? Could it go up a little in sound?
We never anticipated, like, getting someone to pay for James Brown going,
For me, the most definitive sound in hip-hop is, like, the sound of a needle skipping over a scratchy record.
And the best sound of hip-hop is sampling, you know what I'm saying? Because, you know, that's the style that made hip-hop hip-hop.
But then, as the realization dawned on the music business that this was a new sound and a new way of making music that could sell a lot of copies, then naturally the lawyers moved in, and the phrase, where there's a hit, there's a writ.
Just at the time that technology is enabling anybody to be a creator, so just when it matters most, the law steps in and destroys the opportunity that otherwise would exist for people to create and express themselves.
But it's happened at such an accelerating speed that the lawyers are still caught in laws that were built and written many, many years ago.
We don't really quite know what to do about this.
To me as a DJ, sound is always a reflection of the social conditions and environment we live in. It's a mirror.
It was always a culture of borrow and take, because it was a culture that was founded upon a lack of resources.
The idea of not having any instruments, but having a turntable and saying, well, fine, this is my instrument.
Everything comes from that. It's the sum of the parts of everything around you.
And you'll hear that moment that they sampled from in the mix of, like, the sea of sound.
We don't make song based on sample. We have a song first and find it to the perfect sample.
The main reason I still sample is tonally. I want the sound of it.
But I'm more like
a sound kind of girl, to make it, you know, when I transform it or I slur it. When I say slur it, I just kind of drag it to make it sound funky. Like, you know, and you just kind of have that ear and you just kind of think of certain things and you just kind of go for what you know.
What's being stolen or transformed or appropriated or borrowed or digested or what have you is never really the melody. It's never the song that the lawyers are interested in protecting and building a fence around. It's the timbres.
A good appropriated sample has those two qualities. It has a good quality of its own, and it has a strong reference that evokes cultural resonance as well.
As an MC, I'm almost compelled to make pop culture references just so I can make a point clearly enough.
I mean, one of the things I think people don't sometimes think about is that sound itself has a historical dimension.
That's what's cool about sampling, that it transports the listener, if they're willing to move in that pathway, back to a specific action.
Sampling is like the color red. It's like saying, is the color red creative? Well, it is when you use it creatively.
To take all of the remnants of the past and make something new out of that is perhaps the intrinsic power of our generation.
I think collage is the art form of the 20th century, not to mention the 21st. It's not extraordinary or rare.
I've never really heard a completely original musical idea by anyone.
Especially in music, which of all art mediums is based on copying as far as I can see.
Not all of this stuff is mine. I mean, it almost feels like, to a degree, it's public property.
Okay, you can bring up the lights. So what I want to do for the rest of my talk for the next 12 minutes or so is talk about the historical and legal dimensions that have confronted the controversies that cropped up after digital sampling became commonplace after the rise of hip hop in the late 80s, as well as touch on some of the ethical arguments surrounded it as well. So a lot of the kind of knee-jerk reaction is that copyright owners should be able to control any aspect of the property any way that it may be used. And that's not entirely true. In fact, the history within the United States has demonstrated that courts and Congress have consistently upheld a kind of balance that balanced the rights of copyright owners to profit and also to a certain extent control how they use it, but also it's enabled new technologies to use copyrighted goods in ways that sometimes make owners feel uncomfortable. So as far back as 1909, Congress made it possible with the 1909 Copyright Act to enable cover versions, something that was controversial at the very beginning of the 20th century, where suddenly this new technology of this new recording technology emerged that allowed for people to take the songs that were reprinted on sheet music and create their own versions of it. It enabled, for instance, Aretha Franklin to be able to sing Respect, something that, and in fact, sort of make it her own. In fact, Otis Redding, the original author of the song, once said that little girl stole my song, jokingly, because no one really associates it with Redding anymore, and rather she made it her own. And that kind of legal freedom and artistic freedom has been enabled since the 1909 Copyright Act, which established a compulsory license, a statutory license for sound recordings that basically says that if you, as long as you pay a statutory fee set by Congress, you are allowed to cover a song. Even William Shatner can butcher the Beatles' Lucy in the Sky with Diamonds. If anyone's ever heard that song, you know what I'm talking about. But I guess I can quote it. Pitch yourself on a boat on a river with tangerine trees and marmalade skies. So surely that probably made Lennon or McCartney uncomfortable, maybe not, maybe it made them laugh. But the point is, William Shatner and Aretha Franklin had the right to be able to cover and reinterpret those songs. In the case of digital sampling, though, I didn't get to play all of the work in progress. You can find it on the web at copyrightcriminals.com. You can download it, in fact, and keep it on your computer. We've released the work in progress version, and future we'll release future versions with a Creative Commons license, which will be discussed right after me. So I won't go into it. Instead, I'll let Mia fill in the holes. But you can go and download this song, and I'm sorry, this clip. And it further explains kind of the history of the emergence of this new technology and the way this old creative practice, this creative practice of collage, was employed by hip-hop artists in the mid-80s, and for a short period of time, 4 or 5 years, there's the creative window was flung wide open, and mainly because it was a subcultural musical form that really didn't get much attention paid to, and a lot of people, groups like Public Enemy, of which Chuck D is the frontman, and other groups like De La Soul were able to use and explore the creative possibilities and potentials to the max of this new technology. So what ended up happening by the early 90s is the genre became popular. That kind of creativity was shut down by the major labels, which were both getting sampled and releasing albums with samples on them. So a whole new layer of sample license, a whole layer of licensing systems emerged and surrounded and constrained this kind of creative practice. And it's something that I document more extensively in the book, and in fact, the title of the documentary, Copyright Criminals, This is a Sampling Sport, is essentially a multimedia version of that chapter. This documentary will essentially bring to life the story that I tell on the page. So in the case of digital sampling, unlike cover versions that have been enabled, that have been legalized since 1909, copyright owners can create barriers to this kind of creativity by, well, censoring the sampling of sounds that they own. They can also demand prohibitively high, expensive fees. And they can also assert that all unauthorized sonic recontextualizations are theft. Something that unfortunately appeals court recently upheld in late 2004 when it stated that any no matter how transformative it is, any sonic quotation is a theft, and they said get a license or don't use it, and we don't see this as a constraining creativity whatsoever. That was about the last line of the ruling. So, as I mentioned, I alluded before to the Beatles, and so the Beatles are notorious for not allowing for sampled reinterpretations of their work, even though there have been tons of butchered covers of Beatles songs since the 1960s. I mentioned William Shatner, but there are many more. Mae West does a great version of Twist and Shout, which is actually not a Beatles song, but it's a Isley Brothers song that the Beatles covered. So one thing that I propose in the chapter is a way out of the sampling impasse that I document in this documentary and in the chapter is to basically catch the law up with these contemporary creative practices and technological forms by instituting a similar version of a kind of statutory or standardized licensing fee that that would make it possible for, well, copyright owners to be compensated, but and also you know, new artists working at least in these new technological forms to not be constrained. I basically argue that, you know, it's reasonable and it's, you know, actually possible to come up with such a system. These compulsory or statutory licenses ensure that no owner can price competitors out of the marketplace or prevent musicians or radio stations from remaking or rebroadcasting songs. And so this system both promotes the creation and dissemination of new works and it sets limits on the powers of copyright holders while still respecting their rights. It's a win-win situation. However, at the present moment, our copyright regime cultivates a situation where legitimate works of art can be banned regardless of their merits, just because they quote from and transform sounds. So a version of this compulsory licensing system for sampling could solve this problem, but record companies almost certainly will resist this change because of the short-term profits they see, because, you know, they can and do charge upwards of 20,000 or upwards of 250,000 sometimes for particular samples. And so, yeah, when is the last time the music industry has done the right thing on its own? So I have no illusions that you know, we're going to work our way out of this impasse, but it's a completely reasonable solution to this kind of crisis in this particular art form that, you know, that history has demonstrated is a real possibility. Now, I wanted to wrap up by talking about some of the ethics surrounding and the ethical arguments surrounding appropriation, not just in sound, but just the appropriation of words in some cases. So, I mean, this anxiety is hardly new. I mean, as far back as, you know, Socrates, he watched the first new technology of print emerge and was unsettled by it because, you know, after all, as he argued, he believed that the new medium of writing would scatter and can scatter stray images and could have unintended effects. He didn't actually write this because he didn't write down his thoughts. Rather, through Plato, he's recorded as saying, "When it has been written down, every discourse rolls about everywhere, reaching indiscriminately," he argued. So his critique of writing was concerned with the fact that the voice, once captured on paper, could then be forced into conversations that the author never intended, including this conversation right now. So recording technologies also, you know, skipping forward 2,000 some odd years, recording technologies also complicate these issues of ownership and an authorship. And they also give the death of the author a new meaning, especially when authors, I'll use the example of musicians, really do die but are resurrected in advertisements or new recordings. So, I mean, I wonder how John Lennon felt when he was posthumously forced to rejoin the Beatles, a group that he hated by the end of his career with them, to promote the Beatles anthology documentary miniseries when they exhumed a demo recording Free as a Bird, and then the three, you know, well, they were still alive at the time, George Harrison was still alive, the remaining three live members surrounded his voice, his recording, and created a new Beatles song. Similarly, Jimi Hendrix's estate sold his image to be used in a Pepsi commercial that portrayed a young Jimi Hendrix switching from the accordion to the electric guitar because of an epiphany caused by Pepsi. It's also interesting the ways in which this digital technology really does kind of keep alive culturally the voices of dead musicians, especially musicians who were explicitly working within the medium, the digital medium. I'm thinking particularly of Tupac Shakur, who was shot in 1996, I think, or 96, and is sold somewhere around 10 times as many records dead than alive. And that's because his, well, first of all, the genre of hip hop is a producer's medium where basically his voice has been, you know, stripped of the original tracks. And most recently, Eminem produced an entire album by Tupac that's going to be released in a week or two, or maybe it's already out, and constantly keep the sounds that surround his voice, surround it with a contemporary sound so that it's, he even though he's dead, he can still remain alive and of the moment, sound of the moment. Nevertheless, Tupac was basically posthumously forced to do a duet with Notorious B.I.G., who is also dead, someone who he had a really fraught relationship with, and maybe they reunited and are friends in the afterlife, but who knows? Now, I don't want to fall into the trap of, you know, this romanticized notion of intentionality and what would the author do. That's not my point of discussing this. It's just to bring up some of the ethical complications and also to kind of mark some of the discourses that surround these technologies. So I just wanted to end with, one of the people who I'm working with in the film, the co-producer is Ben Franzen, a media artist who lives in Atlanta, but someone who's working with us on the soundtrack and other components of the film is Paul Miller, or DJ Spooky, who tonight in Atlanta is performing his Rebirth of a Nation, which remixes the Birth of the Nation, that ugly racist cinematic classic. You know, some people might say, fortunately, it just barely survived. It barely survived being rescued by the Sonny Bono Copyright Term Extension Act, which basically froze the public domain. But the Birth of the Nation is actually in the public domain, just barely. And so he can do with it what he wants. But if he were working with a material that were still under copyright and had some author connected to it, even if that author is likely dead, that when you're reworking works of art that are connected to live authors or famous authors, it brings up lots of ethical questions, what if questions. And someone might say, what if a member of the KKK took DJ Spooky's contemporary remixed art and reworked it in a way that was offensive to Paul Miller, who's African American, and you hear all sorts of what if questions in debates surrounding free speech, for instance. But the Supreme Court has addressed many of these concerns, the U.S. Supreme Court, it's replied that the First Amendment exists to protect even offensive speech as long as it doesn't cross the line into provoking violence. And, you know, I argue and others should that democracy should be offensive. I mean, it should tolerate uncomfortable ideas or sounds or images. And if someone is insulted, they have the right to stand up and speak back. And it's true that those with more power, larger media megaphones, can often shout louder, but no one should be muzzled by copyright law when it comes to political speech or social critique in any medium. The Supreme Court has reiterated this. I mean, today, oral forms of communication aren't the only kinds of speech that are out there. Sounds and images can often be more persuasive than the spoken word, but intellectual property laws can also forcefully control them, control and constrain that speech when wielded by what I call overzealous copyright bozos. I mean, we live in a consumer culture, to wrap up, and that sometimes obscures the fact that we first and foremost live in a democratic society. And giving up control is part of the democratic bargain, but it's also what some legal scholars call the copyright bargain. It's also, giving up control is also part of the copyright bargain that's written into the U.S. Constitution. So I'd like to end here and continue with discussion, but I want to catch the last talk. Thank you so much for your time.
's and last but not least, my name is Megan Boler. I'm from the University of Toronto and a very delighted member of the Cyber-Disciplinarity Institute. And I think we all have to thank, you can imagine how happy I am to be part of the Institute, given the brilliant sampling that you see that Mark Williams has orchestrated in putting these talks together today. It's really a phenomenal segue between one and the other. We're very fortunate to have Mia Garlick with us today, both for her impressive legal expertise and her cutting-edge work in the area of copyright, particularly in relation to digital media intellectual property, and because, judging from last night, she's a witty and dynamic speaker. Mia joined Creative Commons as general counsel after working in the Silicon Valley office of the law firm Simpson, Thatcher, and Bartlett on a range of shareholder and securities, antitrust, and intellectual property litigation matters. Prior to this, Mia completed a Master's of Law at Stanford in 2003, specializing in law, science, and technology. She received her Bachelor of Arts and a Bachelor of Law from the University of New South Wales in 1998. Before her Stanford studies, Mia worked as an IP associate in the Sydney office of Gilbert and Tobin Lawyers. Her legal work specializes in communications, technology, and intellectual property law. She has advised clients from a diverse range of industries, including publishing, music, software, internet, and related technology industries. And throughout her legal career, she's regularly acted on a pro bono basis for individual creators, giving them legal advice on IP and related issues. She's also written numerous articles on current issues in IP and technology law. And when you look up her work on Google, you find all sorts of publicly accessible projects that she's done either in PowerPoint or in legal documents. And you'll see her quoted widely in reports and blogs. And her publications include a very thoughtful analysis of the Napster revolution in the Communications Law Bulletin 2001 archive. So I know many of us have been looking forward to her talk. And without further ado, Mia Garlick.
Thanks very much. While my computer and presentation gets set up, I'll just start by a brief introduction to say that back in 2002, Creative Commons ran a contest to invite members of the public to put together a very brief, moving, preferably remixed series of images to see if they could better describe our mission than we could. And I'm very glad, of course, that they did, because now here I am 3 years later, and it seems like you have to have a video to participate in this symposium, and so I come well equipped once the technology actually gets set up. So if you just wait one moment. Audio, right? There we are. Is that on? People have been able to, in the physical space, ignore the All Rights Reserved logo that, if you actually go back home and look at your CDs, is affixed to most of your CDs. And what happens then when that gets translated into the internet is that everybody starts doing all the things that they thought they could do with items anyway, and obviously that has a tremendous effect on the content owners' business models. It also, if that got taken away, people would really start to wonder about the cultural products that they own and be rather annoyed about it. And the issue that we currently have is that copyright owners are tending now to legislate to protect and also to technologically devise locks that are going to enforce an all rights reserved strategy, so that we're really going to move to this very passive permissions culture. So that's sort of one of the themes that is running along as Creative Commons is trying to provide a solution of reasonable copyright. The other theme is that often creators don't understand about copyright, or if they do understand about it, they don't know what to do about it. Many of us don't really realise that the minute we write a paper, the minute we take a photograph, make a video, the default position is an all rights reserved position. And unless you clearly signal to the contrary, when I see your photograph or read your paper, I have to assume I'm not allowed to do anything with it other than make a fair use of it. And even then, you try to get a lawyer to tell you, honestly, what the bounds of fair use are. You get all kinds of responses, and I will give them to you as well when I'm putting my lawyer hat on of, well, it depends on the circumstances, and it's, you know, whatever's reasonable in circumstances, very factually complex, etc. The third theme that Creative Commons is dealing with is the fact that even for those creators that do understand what the nature of copyright is, they have no other option about the kinds of rights that they want to attach to their work. And that's because a lot of the cultural industries have been set up so that you have to either assign all of your copyright or give an exclusive license to them in order to be able to get your work distributed out there, because they've controlled the distribution mechanisms and the promotion means. And obviously the internet has completely changed that, but individual creators don't necessarily have the tools to signal otherwise, because you've got to go find a lawyer, it's time consuming, it's expensive, and lawyers are really boring. So Creative Commons' mission is really about giving away free tools, and these are private tools that are based in copyright and contract, and they are they're designed to enable creators to do clear signaling on their work to say that we're not going by the default all rights reserved position, we're actually going by a reasonable, modified, balanced, some rights reserved position. So now I think I might just try to see if the technology is going to actually work for me here, and I'll show you, hopefully, the video that somebody else came up with to describe what we're all about. If I could have sound.
Always we'll on the path.
Okay, and of course, that's available at our website under a Creative Commons license. Anyway, so this was the fabulous slide before that was visually representing what the debate that I was talking about, and here was the fabulous slide that I was talking about earlier representing how we are the reasonable green field. And so essentially what Creative Commons is designed to do is to promote collaboration across time and space. So our strategy is really threefold. The first is to get CC licensed content out there that's more flexibly licensed. The second is to improve the searchability so that users, I'm going to be on the side of the user in this debate because I'm really not that creative, we can find much more content that we can copy, that we can use, that we can adapt. And then also a lot of our strategies are to remind people and encourage people to promote reuse. And I'll talk about a fabulous sampling project that we've been working on recently. So essentially it's trying to move from this permissions culture to a participatory culture. So just sort of some of the details about how we actually do that. We're a non-profit. We're based in San Francisco, California. But we have actually ported to 15 jurisdictions around the world by volunteers, and that's actually been one of the tremendous things about what we do, that the ideas of Creative Commons resonate so amazingly around the world that people in all kinds of jurisdictions are happy to be a part of it, and that's growing every month. So what we do is we offer free legal and technological toolkits. The first is the CC licenses, the second are our publishing tools, and the third are our tools to find things. And I just wanted to briefly go through each of those and then also finish up by talking about some of the direct applications of Creative Commons so that people can find them later on if they want to have a look at it. So just briefly, we have a staple licensing suite. This is our sort of core licensing suite. Every Creative Commons license allows people to copy and distribute a work, provided that they attribute the author or licensor. And then in addition, the creator or licensor can then choose the following conditions, whether it's non-commercial, non-derivative, share alike. Just briefly, non-commercial just says, you know, please use my photograph, but please don't profit from it. No derivative says you can copy and redistribute my song, but please don't sample it. And share alike, for those who are familiar with sort of open source things, is like the copy left provisions. So basically, if you make a derivative work, you have to license it under the same terms. And if that all sounded really complex and like you didn't really understand it, you'll really like the fact that our ability, our license generator page is really easy to understand. It's just, do you want others to make commercial use, etc. And the one thing I do want to stress here that is often a misconception that people give back to us is that this is not about individual creators not being able to make any money from their work. Individual creators can sell their work for $1 million if they can find the buyer for it. This is about what other people can do with your work in addition to whatever commercial transactions you as a creator may enter into. And so that's a very important point it's a very important point to remember. And so just briefly in terms of how it's all structured, we have three different codes. The first is the human readable code, Commons Deed, where we have like the basic license characteristics structured. So that's the ones I just talked about. Attribution is always there. Then whether you want non-commercial or commercial use is permitted, then whether it's derivatives or not. And then we have the lawyer readable code, which is what I'm trained to read and argue about. And obviously, that's an important part in case anybody ever wants to sue over it, that can stand up in court. And then finally, and this is a very important part of our searchability strategy, which is the machine readable code. Essentially, it's when you choose a license, you get metadata which describes that license. And apparently, I'm told by our technical team, I don't really understand this stuff very well, but it sounds good to me. Our metadata is encoded in RDF, which is Resource Description Framework. And essentially, the purpose of that is to describe the object. So it's not that when you're looking for, you know, find me all works that I can make derivative works out of, you're not going to pull up an HTML page that says derivative works. You're going to actually find an object that has been described to permit derivative works use. And then finally, our logo, which once you have your license, you then apply the logo to the work so that people know that it's CC licensed. And if it's in an online space, that hypertext link goes back to the license on our webpage, so people can go back and see either the human readable or the lawyer readable code and figure out exactly what they can do with the work. Just out of interest in terms of our license distribution, this is sort of the breakdown of the licenses that people use. And the thing that I think is very interesting about this is that the 37%, the light blue here, is the attribution non-commercial share alike license. So essentially people are happy for other people to build on their works. And I think that's a really important thing to think about when you think about what would happen if this was all under an all rights reserved license. There'd be this whole plethora of works that you couldn't build on, whereas with clear signaling, you know that you can. And then the other one is attribution non-commercial no derivatives, but that license then allows people to copy and distribute and share it with their friends, which I think is also an important thing to be able to do on the internet these days. I mentioned that we have a customized suite of licenses. I don't want to go into these in detail, just to highlight two that I'm going to be talking about later. The first is the public domain dedication, where you have a work and you can just dedicate it to the public domain, which effectively means you're saying, I'm not going to be asserting copyright on this. And the other one is the sampling license, which I'm going to be talking about later, which is very specifically useful in the music industry, where basically you say, please take a sample of my work, provided you use it in a transformative setting. I mentioned that we're a global network. This just kind of visually represents that for you. We've got 15 jurisdictions already ported. We're in discussions with another 13. They're in the process of porting. I know Poland is actually launching tonight, and given the time difference, the party's probably already started in Poland. South Africa and South Korea are coming on board within the next month, and we're in talks with 70 countries. So it's a global movement. And in case you haven't read any Finnish documents lately, I thought I'd put this one up here for you. This is what our commons deed looks like in Finnish. They were one of the earliest adopters of our licenses. And this kind of shows you what the translation process involves, which is essentially we're taking the human code and the lawyer code, and we're literally translating it into Finnish. And then we're also translating the legal terms to the specifics of the Finnish jurisdiction. And that really is just tweaks to address particular local laws. The underlying purpose of the licenses of permitting flexible licensing and the conditions that I talked about before still remain. So moving on to the publish side, our technological tools, we have CC Publisher, which is an open source application that runs on all platforms, Windows, Mac and Linux. And it basically allows, it's a very easy to use self-publishing tool for audio and video and increasingly other files, where you can upload them to the Internet Archive. And if you put them under a CC license, you get free hosting, which is a great incentive. So just briefly, you can see here how easy it is. You just drag and drop your MP3 file in there, then you choose your license, which is much like the intuitive license generator on our homepage. You upload it, and then you get a URL, which you can then put on your website or in your scrapbook or wherever else it is that you put things that you want to try to find again. The other key publishing tool that we currently have started when we ran a competition or we released a CD, we had a fantastic array of artists, including the Beastie Boys, Chuck D, David Byrne, Gilberto Gil, Zap Mama. They all agreed to release their tracks on this CD under one of our sampling licenses, and then Wired magazine gave the CD away as part of their, I think it was September 2004 edition. And then as part of our promoting reuse strategy, we conducted a fine art of sampling contest and encouraged people to remix the tracks on that CD and then post it back up to this really fabulous site that we have, and I can say that because I didn't really have anything to do with making it, called CC Mixter. And CC Mixter is really it's like a sort of social networking software application, kind of like Friendster. So basically you can set relationships between the tracks. So, I mean, Kembrew's work has done a lot of, you know, tracing through who sampled whom and then who sampled that. Well, this software does that, and I'm just going to take you through a brief example of that. You can see here, this was one of the tracks from the Wired CD, the Beastie Boys, Now Get Busy. Then down below that, you've got all of the tracks that were posted to CC Mixer that sampled the Beastie Boys track. Oh, I'm sorry, just a moment. And then if we go to the sixth one down, Oceans by Douglas Do-Right, if we click through on that, We go to the Oceans page. We can see all of the tracks that Oceans has sampled from. And then in addition to that, we can then see all of the tracks that sample Ocean. So it's a fabulous way of just being able to trace the way that the songs are mashed together. And then if we go to the track that sampled Oceans, we find the track One Eye Oceans by Deadpan. We click through on Deadpan, and then we can find out all about Deadpan, and we can find out, you know, his homepage, what he pounds on, the things that he likes on CC Mixter, his tracks, the tracks that have sampled his tracks, and so it goes on. The network gets created. So this is a fabulous technology, and we're continuing to host competitions in the hip-hop space with a label, Magnitude, who I'll mention later, to kind of encourage people to get into that reuse and participatory kind of phase. On the find side of things, we have a search engine on our own website where you can just type in and choose whether you want to find works that you can use for a commercial purpose or to build on. I typed in the other day one for sunsets. I found 597 images that matched what I wanted, and you can see there the logos, the buy, non-commercial, share alike logos tell you immediately the type of license. If I click through on the second one there, I get this very pretty photograph of a sunset and a nice poem about there being none in Chicago. But obviously then I could like copy that photograph and know that I could do that without getting sued. Then the open source browser application Mozilla have included a CC, they've embedded a CC search bar in their drop-down menu, and we're up there with Google, Wikipedia, and you know the Merriam-Webster dictionary, so it's quite a feat that we're there, but it provides you, when you have a Mozilla browser, to immediately search for CC stuff when you're in the browser. And our big news recently was that Yahoo has generated a CC search engine, which is great. And I did my sunset search on that, and I came up with this photograph. And when I went down the page, just to make sure that I wasn't showing you stuff that wasn't under a CC license, I found this dedication, which I really like. I don't know if everyone can see it, but basically it says, this image is in the public domain, so they used our public domain dedication. You may use this image for any purpose, including commercial. If you do use it, please let me know. I enjoy seeing what others have created with these photos. And I find that a really powerful statement, because it's a far cry from what a lot of scholars argue are the main motivations for people to make creative work, which is that they want money. This person is just putting their stuff out there to see what other people do with it. So to just come to the conclusion, just to look over what our experience has been to date, we started in 2002. Yahoo now reports there are over 12 million linkbacks to our license, which is huge. Our executive director calculated that that's approximately one out of every 675 web pages that are under a CC license. So that's a great feat to achieve in 3 years. Who are the CC adopters? Well, we've basically come across sort of three main types of adopters. First of all, there's the pragmatist, who's just starting out and they just want to get their content out there. They publish it on their to their own site under a kind of CC license to allow people to copy and distribute it. There's the idealist who agrees with the principle. And then there are artists similar to the people that Kembrew documents who, for them, sampling, recontextualization, that is their art form, and so it would be crazy for them to stop the flow of that. And as I mentioned, we're across all spheres of creative expression, and I just wanted to take one moment to show you some examples of the various different types of industries in which Creative Commons has been utilized. This is Flickr, which is an online photo library. Essentially, you can upload all of your photos there and you can store them there. And if you want to make them public, you can. And Flickr has adopted our license generator so that if you want to upload your photos and you want to make them available to people, you can choose a Creative Commons license to do that with. So you can see this person who is called Tiger Nuts, and they're in Manchester, UK, not Manchester, New Hampshire. They've licensed this photograph under a Some Rights Reserved Creative Commons license, and when you click through on that text, it takes you back to the license and you can see what the use is. And I just thought that was a good theme. We've done sunsets, we're moving on now to the twilight. Magnitunes is a fabulous, innovative record label in the music space that has adopted our licenses. It's a very innovative business model whereby you can stream music from them for free. You pay to download, and all artists put their work up there under an attribution, non-commercial, share alike license. And Magnitune also share royalties with the artists 50%, which is fairly novel in the record industry. in the film space, outfoxed. The producers released the samples that they had the rights to under a Creative Commons license and were prepared to let anyone, even Fox, reuse them. In the academic publishing space, we have the Public Library of Science, who are a dedicated open access journal. They've released content both online and in print form, and both of those formats are under a Creative Commons attribution license, which is our least restrictive license, which means that other people can copy it, distribute it, make derivative works of it, and can make commercial and non-commercial use of it. In the education space, MIT has an open courseware program. Their license, from memory, is non-commercial. It allows derivative works, but it's a share-alike license. So if people do make derivative works from their courseware, then they have to put it under a similar kind of license. And I think also Rice University and several other universities have adopted a similar kind of open courseware philosophy. The blog space has been a very neat fit with Creative Commons since we started out, and there are a few blogs that I come across that don't have a Creative Commons license on them, and I just want to highlight this one. Gary Becker, who is an economics professor at the University of Chicago, and Richard Posner, who's on the Seventh Circuit, have also licensed their blog under a Creative Commons attribution license. And finally, I couldn't go without a plug for my fellow panelist's book. He released his Freedom of Expression book up under a Creative Commons attribution non-commercial share-alike license, so he's happy for people to make derivative works of it. And this is a great example of what I was saying earlier, where just because you've used a Creative Commons license, it doesn't stop you from making any money out of your work. Kembrew has been selling copies of it through Amazon. So that's a possibly sped up story overview of the story of Creative Commons, aiming to change culture one copyright license at a time. Thank you very much.
The table at the front, I think we only have one functional microphone. So please continue to share.
Test.
Sure.
It sounds like it will pick us all up.
If we just shout.
Both are working?
Maybe I could ask a question to start with, since there wasn't a question. What if when you're licensing material to make something else and you have to, you know, sign an agreement that limits its usability? In the past, you know, for example, our Einstein project, where we had to be dealing with Princeton, Hebrew University, Caltech, the family agency, all of those licenses restricting its use of any of those materials. How do you handle that with Creative Commons?
Well, unfortunately, I mean, to the extent that people, where you've got upstream content and the upstream licenses are very restrictive, more on the all rights reserved model, you're really hamstrung in being able, you can't release that stuff under a Creative Commons license. You can only release stuff under a Creative Commons license, you know, that you have the rights to, or you have permission from the upstream licensor to do that. But, I mean, basically, this isn't stopping. This is growing. And I really think that as you know, more organisations get beyond that, and now we're starting to liaise with very prominent industry groups to try to make sure that they're on board and not telling their members that they can't adopt Creative Commons licences, hopefully then the pressure will start coming on those organisations that have traditionally said no when they're licensing you the content, that they will feel that they are able to do it. And also I think as more people see that the world doesn't end just because you give up some of your rights.
One of the reasons why the version that we have on the web that we've placed on archive.org and has a Creative Commons license, the reason why it doesn't have any of the particular hip-hop songs, for instance, that some of the artists talk about, is for partially that reason, just because we're not at the advanced stage yet where we can confidently claim fair use. That's something that we're working on with our lawyer, working on the parameters surrounding what we can fairly use of in including audio quotations or video quotations. So we just have the music supplied to us by Paul Miller, DJ Spooky. And so it's just our footage that we've shot and the music. And that way we can confidently, you know, put it out and yeah. make it available for anyone. And it's a share-alike license. So, you know, people are already starting to incorporate it into people have incorporated some video and sound clips into some of their own work, actually. So it's already taken on a life of its own. And to quickly replug CC Mixter that Mia showed us, about 3 days after we posted our clip online, there was already music about it. There was already like a rap about copyright criminals. This is a sampling sport that then was remixed and remixed and remixed. And so next time we release the next work in progress version on the web, the credit sequence is going to be that song from CC Mixter, or one of the songs from CC Mixter. So it's this great feedback loop.
GarageBand actually does have our licenses as an option for people who want to do that. The instance that you're talking about with Nine Inch Nails, I'm not aware of any association. We know of it because it was discussed on our sampling list. That's another thing I should plug. If people are interested in this and they want to get involved in debates and discussions, we have a bunch of lists that people can get involved in to ask questions about and contribute to the community. And this has been discussed on the list. They haven't adopted any Creative Commons license for this, but I think the philosophy is similar. It's just like putting the stuff out there just to see what people are going to do with it, which has worked amazingly for Kembrew and, you know, which the sunset photographer person was curious about. I mean, it's the same kind of philosophy.
Mia, question. I write some software depending upon who's paying for it or whether it's my own loss of sleep. Sometimes it's public domain, other times it's GPL. Now, oftentimes when I release something in public domain, it's just stated very clearly at the top, this is public domain, do what you will with it, have fun, please let me know. Would there be any benefit to a creator to adopt CC's specific public domain language rather than just a simple blur?
Of course, we are the answer to everything. no, seriously. it depends. It depends what you want to do, really. I mean, we just give people the tools and the options. I mean, if you adopt our licenses, what I can tell you is you've had a lot of lawyers caused a lot of lawyers grief in drafting those things. I mean, we've had pro bono assistance. I mean, we obviously have internal lawyers. Then we have pro bono assistance from Cooley Godward and Wilson Sonsini, two very top Silicon Valley law firms. We also have an awful lot of lawyers and legal professors on the board. And this thing gets lawyered to death before we release it. So if that gives you more comfort in, you know, adopting something that's been lawyered to death rather than your own statement, feel free to do so. But the public domain dedication is kind of an interesting one because that's a really untested area. So we can't actually point to a case and say, well, this says that this definitely works. It's really a statement of good faith and intention for people to rely on.
Thank you.